Let's continue discussing the remaining components of the image intensifier tube. The output phosphor is also composed of cesium iodide, so when the electrons from the photocathode interact with it, their kinetic energy is transformed into visible light. As stated previously, since the electrons reaching the output phosphor are more highly concentrated, the result is a brighter, visible light image produced. It should be noted that the image received at the output phosphor is upside down compared to the image received at the input phosphor. This is because of the focal point created at the anode within the image intensifier. In the image on the left, imagine an X-ray photon to the left of the image intensifier representing imagery of the patient's stomach. As we follow the path the energy takes through conversion through the image intensifier, it reaches a focal point and continues traveling to the opposite side of the output phosphor. This is easily correctable within the display components, which we'll discuss later. Let's talk about brightness gain. There are two processes that contribute to intensifying the image, ultimately resulting in the final brightness achieved in the light image emitted from the II toward the TV camera or other recording devices. These are flux and minification. Minification gain is the ratio between the input phosphor screen size, or the diameter, to the output phosphor screen size. The mathematical formula can be expressed as the diameter of the input phosphor squared divided by the diameter of the output phosphor squared. In your textbook, the example given has a 30 centimeter input phosphor and a 2.5 centimeter output phosphor. The formula for diameter is pi times radius squared. For the input phosphor, that's 3.14 times 15 squared, which equals 706.5 square centimeters. For the output phosphor, that's 3.14 times 1.25 squared, which equals 4.9 square centimeters. These round to 707 and 5 respectively. The result is 141.4, meaning the brightness of the light emitted from the image intensifier will be 141 times greater than the light originally emitted from the input phosphor from the minification process alone. Flux gain is also used to calculate total brightness gain. If you recall, flux gain was the ratio in the number of light photons at the output phosphor to the number of X-ray photons at the input phosphor. Your textbook gives us an example where a particular flux gain for an image intensifier is equal to 70. To find brightness gain, you would multiply the flux gain, which was 70, by the minification gain in the previous example of 141. The result is that the total brightness or brightness gain is 9,870, meaning that the light at the output is 9,870 times brighter than the original brightness at the input phosphor. Typical brightness gains can range from 5,000 to as much as 20,000. Now think of those radiologists in the first video in this section who were being bombarded by X-ray photons coming from the patient to their faces. Think of the patient exposures that must have been happening without this technology, and the reduction in dose we experience today because of it. It's no lie that today is the safest it's ever been in the field of radiography. The International Commission of Radiologic Units and Measurements recommends evaluating the brightness gain of image intensifiers based on the conversion factor. This is the ratio of the luminance of the output phosphor to the input exposure rate measured in millirankin per second. The candela is the unit of measurement for luminance or light intensity. This method is considered far more accurate and reproducible than the older method for calculating brightness gain, which was measured by an estimation of flux rather than the actual measured quantities. Since the conversion factor is approximately 0.01 times the brightness gain, image intensifiers typically have a conversion factor of 50 to 200. Most modern IIs are multi-field image intensifiers and possess magnification modes. Multifield image intensifier tubes are designed to have a variable field of view. The larger the input phosphor, the larger the field of view will be, which is useful for examinations where a large area of the patient's anatomy must be viewed. A lower GI series is a good example for this. Because less panning is required, studies can be kept shorter potentially. When magnification mode is selected, this simply shifts the focal point within the image intensifier closer to the input side. As this happens, the electron field widens or gets larger at the output. Since the size of the output phosphor does not change, this just causes a smaller portion of the patient anatomy to be visible within the field of view. This helps with image resolution since the number of pixels available at the output is the same, yet the area of anatomy inputted into the image intensifier is smaller, meaning there are more pixels per area of anatomy. This also causes the image to be much dimmer. When there is less input light, the minification gain is reduced. We'll talk about automatic brightness control soon, which should compensate for this loss of brightness, which causes a lower signal-to-noise ratio. Unfortunately, mag mode requires increased MA, so skin dose does increase for the patient. The radiologist must consider all of these factors when opting to operate the fluoroscope in magnification mode.